Hi, everyone. Welcome back to Your Money Matters. I am your host and publisher of the Bauman Letter, Angela. And joining me are Clint Lee and, of course, Ted Bauman from a secret location that we cannot disclose. I'm kidding. He's in Virginia.
I'll give you a hint. We're having steamed crabs for dinner, so that'll give you a hint.
Sounds good to me. As a reminder for those of you watching, if you want more information about the Bauman Letter, we do talk about it a lot. You can try it completely risk-free. In fact, if you don't like what you see, we'll refund your money on the very last day of your subscription. So please click above or below for more information. Again, it can't hurt to check it out. Now, we are having a pretty rough week. The Dow is on track for its worst week. And again, we record this on Fridays. It's on track for its worst week since January. So we're going to take a look at these markets, see what's going on. We're going to dig into some specific stocks, which is always fun to see if anything is bottomed out. But first, if this reflation trade is challenged by the Fed's recent move, and growth stocks are still expensive, where do investors go? And Clint, you know, I like to pick on you. Let's take a closer look by taking a look at some specific sectors, if we could, and how they've responded to the Fed.
I think if you look at how the sector rotation has played out just over these last couple of days, that tells you a lot about where investors are seeing some opportunities now. So first, here's just a graph of the S&P 500 along with all the underlying sectors. This is the performance for the last 5 days, so capturing kind of, it's been a rough week. The S&P for the last 5 days down 1.6%, but it would have been a lot worse than that had the tech sector not held in there. Tech sector up 0.4%, but it was the only S&P sector that's positive over this 5 day stretch. And you start working your way down this list, and something really jumps out at you, especially when you get to the worst performing sectors. You know, you look at the bottom four. You've got industrials and energy are down 3.6%, but then financials and materials down 6% apiece. Once again, this is just over the last 5 days. And those are all your more cyclical sectors of the market. And just to show you how dramatic this turn has been, here's a chart that shows the KBW bank ETF against the S&P 500. So the bank ETF is the blue line on here. The S&P is the red line on here. This goes back 3 months. You see where this 3 month stretch, the banks were keeping pace with the S&P for the most part, both up around 7% over that period. And then you can see this, just this, the blue line, the bank ETF just falling off a cliff here. The S&P trending lower as well, but this KBW ETF now down about 2.5% over that 3 month stretch. So, you know, that's at the sector level. But then you start to see a similar story unfold when you look more broadly at the index level. So, you know, when I think of an index that tracks cyclicals, probably the most popular index out there for that is going to be the Dow Jones Industrial Average. So here's a chart of what the Dow's done. This goes back to last year because I want to illustrate something important. If you can see for the first time in a long time, the Dow is starting to slash below the 50-day moving average. That's the black line on here. Just recently, over these past few days, the Dow is closing below the 50-day. That has held as key support going all the way back to October, November of last year. I mean, you got to go back to October to find the last time that the Dow was performing this badly and starting to dip below at least the 50-day moving average. On the other side of that, you know, one of the growth areas, a growth ETF that we like to pick on a lot here, the ARK Innovation ETF, ARKK. Here's the same time frame for ARKK, but a much different story. For the first time in a while, it's now starting to close above its 50-day moving average. So the ARK Innovation ETF recapturing that black line here just over these last couple of days in the wake of the Fed meeting kind of shows you once again where we're seeing that rotation at.
All right. Now, Ted, I know you're being held hostage right now in a basement, but if you could please, I know you touched on this on Friday, but if you could explain why the market has reacted the way that it has, I'd appreciate it.
Sure. Well, the first thing to say is that the market actually didn't know how to react in the first instance. It reacted in two different ways on the same day, basically. So here's a chart that shows the 10-year Treasury yield over the last five trading sessions. And you can see what happened yesterday. It skyrocketed, right? There was a bond sell-off right around the time that the Fed, you know, started reporting on their meeting, because everybody thought, oh, they're gonna tighten rates and you know, we need to get out. But then they realized, wait a minute, this is saying actually something different. That, you know, once they sat back and thought about what the Fed was actually saying, they realized that there's no need to tighten, you know, these rates. And so as a result, bond yields have actually ended up now lower than they were a week ago, you know, which is really weird. I mean, if you think the Fed's going to be tightening, if you think there's going to be inflation coming, you'd expect bond yields to rise. But in fact, the opposite's happening. People are moving their money into bonds. Now, but this tells a different story. The next chart I want to show you is essentially kind of a proxy for the yield curve. This is a longer term perspective, and that is the 30-year treasury, the 5-year treasury is in blue, and then the 30, I believe, is in green, and the 10 is in red. So look what happens here. I mean, the 5-year yield has shot up, right? But the longer term yields have gone down. So what's going on here? Well, I think the first thing is that essentially the Fed, by saying that they're expecting interest rate increases, but only in 2023, they're essentially saying to the market that in the short term, they're going to be accommodative. So we might see short-term inflation over the while. But by the time we get to 2023, 2024, we might actually have a scenario where the economy is starting to slow down. Right. And so as a result, you know, they're willing to hold those longer bonds because they think by that point, then, you know, the real yield will be acceptable. So this calls into question the reflation trade. Right. I mean, this is basically the notion that we're headed for strong economic growth, that we're headed for strong inflation and all that. Well, the Fed is saying, the inflation is a little bit higher than we think, but we don't really think we're going to do anything about it for the next couple of years. So that really means that in the short term, we may have a robust economy for a couple of quarters, but then it's back to business as usual. And of course, on top of that, we have the fact that the Democrats clearly are playing their normal game of not achieving anything in office and probably not going to deliver on any of their infrastructure plans. And as a result, you know, we're kind of back to where we were after the great financial crisis. The market is expecting more of the same, which is slow, dawdling growth. Most of the action in the stock market is going to be on speculative side of things with low interest rates over the longer period. So it's really calling into question a lot of what we were all talking about earlier this year.
What are investors supposed to do? I love to ask you this question because God knows I don't have the answer.
Well, I think, look, I mean, the first thing is let's have a look at the yield curve, because that's really the key thing that the market is looking at. And that's really the relationship that I just showed you between longer dated yields and shorter dated. A month ago, the green line shows you where the yield curve was. And you can see that the longer dated yields were higher. Now they've dropped very significantly. In other words, they're moving back in the direction that they were when the pandemic was still raging. And that reflects the fact that I think the market is starting to discount this notion that we're headed for extraordinary growth, you know, thanks to stimulus spending and all of that over the next couple of years. How quickly things change. I mean, basically, here's a chart that shows what the Bank of America thinks is going to do to various sectors of the economy, including some that, you know, have seen a lot of action recently. Home builders down, copper down, materials down, transportation down. All these things that are related to the so-called reopening trade, they're predicting that they're going to go down. All right, so you asked me what to do. Well, I think investors are going to flee to safety. And here's a company that is kind of spring-loaded for investors who want safety. And that's Amazon, of all places. I know it's an expensive stock, but of course, you can buy it now in fractional shares. But look at this long period of consolidation going back to September last year. It's really been trading in this range. And we're starting to see, you know, the potential for a breakout here. We're starting to see the potential for it to pop above that shaded box. And if it does, it could break out higher. And the reason why it would do that is because people say, okay, you know, the cyclical trade has flopped. The high flying growth stocks are still risky. We're still seeing a lot of bad news in the press about the so-called SPAC phenomenon and how it's turned out in some cases. So let's go looking for safety. And what is safe? Well, people are going to keep buying stuff from Amazon. And it sure looks like Jeff Bezos has his control, you know, so that's where he's going to go.
All right, Clint. And what about a couple stocks from you that, you know, are either dipping or just trading sideways that you think, as Ted said, might be spring loaded and ready to come back to life?
Yeah, so I was looking for some names that, like you said, have dipped from their recent highs, but reflation trade or not, or growth, whatever it is, you know, I want to look for names that have longer term secular tailwinds in place that they seem to benefit from that. You know, it's just not a bet on the yield curve, so to speak. So the one that came to mind was something that can leverage sort of the tailwinds that are behind data centers, especially with the 5G build out. And that's with Advanced Micro Devices, ticker AMD. Just the other day, they announced a big win with Google Cloud Computing. They're taking more share in that data center market. And here's a chart of the stock price going back about a year or so here, and just highlighting that how AMD had pulled back off its high from around $100 a share. And you had this downtrend line that I'm highlighting with the dashed line on the price chart here. But then just the other day, breaking above, we had a really strong price action above that that downtrend line. That came on a surge in volume that I'm highlighting with the arrow in the volume panel. And at the same time, you get the momentum picking up as illustrated with the MACD. We're recapturing the 200-day moving average, a green line on here as well. So just, you know, everything signaling a breakout in place right here with AMD. And then one other one I thought of was someone that can leverage the build out in the EV space, someone that is going to be positioned to have to supply some of the electric vehicle infrastructure that's needed. And that was with Blink Charging, ticker BLNK. And they have 23,000 charging stations already across the US and some international locations. This is another one where you can look at a potential breakout here of a consolidation in a stock that has come well off its high. So here's the chart for Blink. After peaking out, so around that $60 level, we had the dip in share price all the way down to about 25. But then, as I'm highlighting with the green box on here, we've just been trading in this range going all the way back to February. And we're starting to now see some positive signs that a breakout could be taking place. If you want to be a little bit more conservative, wait for it to jump over the top end of this box on here, right around that $45 level. But you've got, you know, the stock bounced off the 200-day. That's a green line. Then it retook the black line, the 50-day at the same time. You're seeing the MACD pick up. So I would anticipate a breakout over 45 is coming here soon for the stock.
Well, there you have it, folks. Three spring-loaded stocks for you, all for free. But again, if you do want specific recommendations, I highly encourage you to join us at the Bauman Letter. Please click the link above and below, and we will see you next week. Thanks so much.